Valentino about the complex Monge-Ampere. Actually, before complex is real, the order is a little switched. These two lectures more or less I want to introduce you some of the basic and Fourier nonlinear equation. And what I'm going to do is a little different. I look some of the some classical examples and see what we go from there. So I want to start a very classical example, so-called the Minkowski problem. Well, suppose now we have a surface and in of Rn of plus 1, and then we know then, of course, each point there is a normal mu. And at each point, then, of course, we have the principal curvatures, the surface of Mn. And suppose it's a convex, then and the Gauss map from M to of Sn, that is a diffeomorphism. And the Minkowski problem is very simple to state in this setting. So suppose then, suppose now, then of course, here, now, Gauss curvature, here equal to the product of kappa of I from 1 to n. That's the Gauss curvature. Now, that's in kind of inverse problem. Suppose now, given you a function of the phi, which belongs to C2 of S of n, suppose this function is positive. And I will put a little bit more. Suppose this function is the satisfy of SG of, I will come back to this later, of phi of Sn, that's equal to 0 for all coordinate functions. So that's very similar to what Valentino discussed about the comparability condition. We come back later, that's a little different. This condition is related to so-called orthogonal to the first eigenvalue, eigenfunction, that's orthogonal to the second eigenfunction functions. So right here, then we want to find a convex half surface of m of n in of Rn plus 1, such that its Gauss curvature at the point of x that's equal to of 1 over reciprocal of this mu inverse of x, or mu of x, for all x in of n. In other words, that's a problem of prescribing Gauss curvature. Okay, so that's a very simple. Well, historically, this this problem, just want to say, n equal to 2, that was solved in 1950s by Neumann and also Pogorov. And for general dimension n, that is had to be with about 20 years later. That's by Chin and Yao, and also Pogorov. So, and here, the method is to prove that, to solve this is using so-called method of continuity. So I will just skip, and you already learned from Valentino, then we have to prove then you take, instead of solving one equation, you solve parameter of equations. And then you want to prove then for those parameter, the equation solvable is open and closed. For the openness and uniqueness, I'm going to skip. That's very classical. So it's very easy. So emphasize here, one you emphasize is this so-called closeness a priori. So now, before I go on, seeing that, in a sense, the reason, the thing related to the Monge-Ampere equation is as following here. So now, because you can see from here, we have principal curvatures, and then this corresponding of lambda j equal to 1 over kappa of j, that's in the convex geometry is called the principal radius. And turns out this guy is, so now also then, there is a very important and function related to the convex body, so called the support function. That's u of x equal to of, and u of x, maybe u of x equal to a normal of at x times of the body of x, for all x in of m. So that's the support function. The support function, of course, you can think about support function defined on the half surface, because this is diffeomorphism. You can also think about support function defined in Sn. So now, instead, we can think about the support function u of, maybe I use different x, maybe I use y. Y, and then letter x, and y corresponding here then to y equal to mu inverse of x. So with this correspondence, then you can see here, then the principal radius lambda g are the eigenvalues of the following and sphere projection. Here, the covariant derivatives are with respect to the metric of standard, that's with respect to the standard metric on Sn. So it's now is very simple here. So, and if you want to relate to what Valentino talked about this morning, then you should still think about this as the g instead of g tilde. So then this will be g tilde. Okay, so it's very similar. Therefore, the Gauss curvature kappa is equal to the one of the determining of u of ij plus delta ij of u. So now we want to solve this equation. So you do the, of course, then you do the, and so that's of course the 20 determining, and u ij plus delta ij of u equal to 1 over 5, because then we define this equal to this back. So then that's the equation. Well, you already seen from this morning in my Valentine talk, determinant has certain kind of diverging free structure. Okay, so now instead of that, I'm going to write down of this sigma n of w. Here, w will be the matrix of u ij plus delta ij of u. And because this w is defined on this way, and we are working on Sn, so this is Kadazi, therefore you can do integration by parts. Okay, then look on here. So then you look on determinant of this equal to 5, because this reciprocal going back. So now, then you multiply of x, and your x of k will determine of u of ij plus delta ij u equal to phi of k. And you do integration of Sa. And this will be equal to, very similar, and here equal to of the following here. So you get equal to of this. This operator acting on here, so that will be becomes sk delta ij plus sk delta ij. And then the cofactor of that, usually are going to write down here of ij of w. And this is easy to compute. For any coordinate function, this is zero. And there is geometric meaning of that, because it is related to so-called translation of the convex body. Translation won't change the normal. therefore the scale is zero. So that means that this equal to zero is a necessary condition. That is necessary condition. They give you the necessary condition. So now we do estimate. So now, well, originally then, and Pogorov is going back to the history. Pogorov announced that somehow he didn't write down everything down, and then there was a lot of things still need to be done. So the basic estimate, or important one, is so-called Qin Yao's estimate, C0 estimate. Well, let's look at this. We want to get an estimate. So now we want to, very similar to this morning talk, we want to retract of G of U of G that equal to zero. Because you see that you have U solution, you add any coordinate function will be also solution. So you don't want to and U move too much. Okay? So that you want to that's this kind of condition. Because you have freedom. You see that if U is solution, you add U plus of any, I don't want to use G, maybe as K, this is also a solution. Okay, so because of any as K of this is zero, so you get a solution. Therefore, you want you too many solutions and you want to make a retraction of that. So that's the condition. And that's equivalent in the geometry called that the origin is the standard point of the convex body. Okay. So now, and the CCU estimate and Qin Yao's estimate tell you that the diameter, not just diameter, U is of any X is less than some constant of C. C will, will do the, don't depend on A. C depends on A and the phi. Larger than equal to some larger than equal to zero. Then for all x of S n. So now let's draw a picture, then you can see from suppose we have convex body, that's of M n. And now suppose now you want to estimate U. U of course more than related to the one you estimate the diameter of this body. So that's the support function here. And that's called this L is the diameter, and this line gives you the length of diameter. And this, of course, is the degenerate, line itself is degenerate convex body. And that's completely inside of this omega. So that's omega equal to boundary of MN. And this L, of course, inside omega. And then by property of then, and because then pick this as the origin, then the support function of U of L is less than equal to support function U of omega. That's very easy to prove that. So now, support function U L you can compute. Easily can compute. And then you multiply of phi both sides. Suppose now phi satisfies the equation of, and U satisfies this equation, then this could determine of W. And now you integrate this over. And this, by diverging formula, that's equivalent to the volume. That's n plus 1, or n plus 1, 1 of n plus 1 of volume of omega. And this, you can bound here, because assume phi is positive, and this can be bounded by some constant only depends on phi. Positive constant, you can compute. So once you have that, and now on the other hand, by isometric inequality, that will be equal to some constant in and the surface area of boundary omega, that's of Mn. Then this surface area can also be written down determined of W. Is it equal to that? Surface area equal to determinant of W. And that is equal to phi. Okay, no, I have a problem here. So that's the boundary. Then I have to be raised of n plus 1 power divided by n. Plus 1 power by n. And then n plus 1 power. So that's the Qin Yao's proof, saying that, therefore, and this will be, then you look at this. So this will be AO, that is more or less by AO, some dimension constant, because that's the length of this, so this diameter of omega, and with some constant C of tilde maybe of that. Therefore, then diameter will be bounded by of this integral. So that's actually a proof. It's a very nice proof, geometrically. So that's give you a C0 estimate. And just a little bit then here that because we pick origin to be at the center of that, because then standard geometry tells you that when standard point is the origin, then these two difference is small. Okay. But anyway, you have diameter estimate, of course, you will have the estimate for the support function. So the support function is bounded from above. Now, then the next one, then you want to put support function bound below. That was another lemma of Chen Yao. But this time, we want to bypass that. You don't need this. As long as, so what do we need then, as long as this is bounded, what do we need here then? We want to put Uij plus delta Iju, which is larger than or equal to some C0 of the identity matrix that we need, and less than C1 of the identity matrix. That is the key we want to prove. That means the principal curvatures are controlled from below and above. Okay? And then use the standard and convex body theory. Once you know that the support function has this property, then there is a unique convex body correspond to of this. It's convex bodies of this support function. And the idea is following here. So let U is the extension of capital X, then equal to U of X, and module X. That is, originally then you would only define an Sn, then you stand as homogeneous degree of a function in Rn plus 1. And then the gradient, so m will be equal to just gradient of capital X U. It's easy just to recover, completely recover the body from this formula. So in any case, we need to get this estimate. Well, also this morning, Valentino tells us that once you deal with determined, if you have upper bound, then you have a lower bound, because determined is larger than equal to some constant one from below. Therefore, we only bound the largest eigenvalue of this W. So now we do estimate. So estimate is very similar to what Valentina did this morning. This is a little different from original proof of Chen Yao. But turns out then that you look at the proof, actually then Yao's proof in the, for the gravity conjecture then probably is better to fit because you're working on compartment instead of projective of RA. So that. Anyway, so now let's, so this time, we can recall factors, so now let's call sigma n of W equal to determinant of W. And then this fact, very important fact we use often, actually also implicitly used this morning in the computation, that sigma n of volume n W is concave in W, as a function of W, when W is positive definite. Okay, that I'm going to use that. So now let's look at this function. So we're thinking about sigma n of W equal to of phi. So instead of taking all that over n, and that's called g of W. So then g, so now we want to estimate, so because now you want to control the largest eigenvalue, equivalent to control the trace of the matrix, because the matrix is positive definite. So trace controls everything. Therefore, let's call H equal to sigma 1 of W, which is a trace. So we need to control this trace. So that's again, we want to use maximum principle. So now, suppose now, of course, this is larger than equal to 0. Then we want to estimate upper bound. So suppose now S0 down to Sn, H at 0 is the maximum of H. So the rest of all the computation will be at that point. So now, what do we do then? Of course, we differentiate. So now, we at that point, we may assume and omega ij equal to u ij plus delta of ij u is diagonal at that point. So now you do the let's denote of g of ij is equal to dg dw of ij. And that's elliptic, we know that's positive definite. That's also used this morning. Okay. So therefore, because at the maximum point, this guy is, because the maximum, this is, and no positive definite. So you contrast with of the positive definite, this is less than equal to zero. So at zero, you have of this. Now let's compute with that is this equal to g of ii, because we assume it's diagonalized. Therefore, equal to h of ii, this means contrast sum all of I from 1 to n, and then that's g of ii, and then this will be wjj of ii, and then sum was i, and then you switch, so g of ii, then g of ijj, exact same thing with this morning, so just more or less repeat with and Valentino did this morning. Then, because now we are working on a manifold of constant curvature equal to 1. So then that equal to g of gj g of ii plus of gjj, wjj. Okay, so you switch 2i to the front and 2j to the, switch all this, I and the j. And then you make a mistake. The commutative formula tells you you have of this term. So now you do that, because you see that this is of polynomial homogeneous degree 1. So then you differentiate, you contrast that. So this is still there, and we come back to deal with this term later. And that will be mass of g. And you do that, this will be you sum of I, sum of j, so that will be equal to sum of j, you get h, sum of I, you have g of ii. And that's, and now also g of I is easy to compute, you can compute g of ii is larger than equal to 1. Okay, that's just direct computation. So now let's deal with this term. This term also was discussed in this morning. Because then, so far we have not used the equation. So now we go back to the equation use, because that this equal to of this. So that will be equal to, then you use the equation, then you differentiate of this equation, g. And then you make mistakes then, because of chain rule, that will be of dg alpha beta, gamma of eta, w alpha of beta, gradient of w, gamma of eta. So now this is g. That's plus h, summation of g, that's 1. So that will be larger than equal to this. And now, as we mentioned, this is concave. Therefore, this is negative, this minus, that's positive. So that's no negative. And this, of course, here, so that will give you then, so from here, that will give you then h is less than equal to of g. G is phi 1 of n, minus Laplace of phi 1 of n. So that's a simple estimate. So you can bound h from of this, again, just in the lunch, and you all made a remark, then all those estimates, you turn out that's only related to the path of right-hand side. Okay, so you have that. So now let me write on that. We will use this later on. So once you have that, then that's different from the counter case. You see then whole hashing will be controlled because you assume hashing is positive definite. You control trace, you control the whole hashing. So you get a C2 estimate. That's a real C2 estimate. Okay, so then C2 estimate follow. That implies C2 estimate. Here then the maximum of H is less than or equal to of phi 1 of N minus the plus phi 1 of N. Okay? And that's of course taking the maximum. Once you have C2, then you can use Calabi's and C3 estimate because that's real Monge-Ampere. And then you can get C3 estimate. And then, again, Valentino did this morning, then you use shorter estimate and bootstrap. So that would imply, and you will be able to see anything that gives you all the priori estimate. All right, so now that's the original and Minkowski problem. The reason why Minkowski introduced this problem actually coming from so-called Brown-Minkowski theory. So now let's go back to very, very quick review so-called of Brown-Minkowski theory. So Brown-Minkowski theory I believe two kind of so-called measures, One is called area measures, and other is so-called curvature measures. For the area measure, more or less than you use so-called mu map, the Gauss map. Relate to Gauss map, and then those kind of measure are the sigma of SN and sigma K of kappa. And the K equal to 1, 2, to N. For each of that so-called error measure, so-called K's error measure. And then this curvature measure is the difference. This area measure living on SN. Curvature measure living on MN. And that's related to the sigma k of kappa. Sigma k of kappa, d sigma of N. That is so-called curvature measure. So when is curvature measure? So Minkowski problem is so-called prescribing N's area measure. Now the question then we want to prescribe and the K's area measure. And that's related to the problem solving this equation. On SN. Again, W represent of this matrix. And K, could you win this special name, so-called the Christoffel problem? And then the intermediate so-called this Christoffel Minkowski problem. And this problem is solved. And K equal to N, that's the Minkowski problem we just discussed. Well, when K larger than N of this, is still open. So today I want to discuss some of the partial result related to the sufficient to solve all this. Okay, so now let's look, work on this equation, see what's happened. So now, we want to use similar things when we get so-called estimate algorithm. So before we introduce them, we need to what mean the solution of this. Solution of that so-called admissible solution let's call this, let's give a name of that one that if gamma is equal to gamma k is all those sigma 1 w greater than 0 up to sigma k of w greater than 0. So those kind of, in general, called the Guardian's cone. Now again, we use this factor here, the factor's quorum here. Then if w beyond 2 of gamma k, then b b sigma k dw rj is positive definite, and sigma k one of k is concave. That's the factor we use. So now, the problem here in general, so there are two kind of questions. The first question, find an admissible solution. And then, of course, going back to this, you see that the Christopher Minkowski problem, not just to solve this equation, of course you have to solve this equation, but you want to find a geometric solution. Geometric means then, because you see that all the correspondents we use Gaussian map as a diffeomorphism. Therefore, the geometric solution, the second question even harder than find a geometric solution. That is, you want to have W is positive definite because you use Gaussian map. So you have to, and that's the main issue we will discuss. So we will work on the a priori estimate from above first. Okay, so here is also the difference as what Valentino this morning did. Once we deal with determining case, once you have C2 solution, if eigenvalue bound from above, then determinant is positive, then you have eigenvalue bound from below. You do not need to estimate a lower eigenvalue. But when k is not equal to a, that's no longer the case. Then you want to, this more or less to estimate eigenvalue from below. So the question one, estimate eigenvalue from above, and then you do the below. Above is much simpler, you will see that, and below we have to work a little hard. So to do above, then also we have problem because for the admissible solution, we do not know is corresponding to the convex body. The origin proof by chain law is those kind of geometric is not applicable. Unless you assume it's geometric, then same proof will apply. Okay. So now we want to bypass that. So that's also, we do not do the C0 estimate. We just jump to C2 estimate first. Okay. So now C2 estimate. For C2 estimate, we do the same thing. So let's G equal to sigma k of W with over k. Now use those two factors. This is positive definite. This is concave. Suppose you forget about all the computation originally with sigma n or determine, just put the g there, use these two factors. Immediately you can get then of h is larger than or equal to 0, less than or equal to the maximum of phi 1 of k minus the plus phi 1 of k. The same proof, it's that simple, without you have that. Okay, then still have a problem because you see that recall H is equal to of and a plus of U plus of N of U because the trace of W. But you don't know U is bounded. Okay, if we know U is bounded, then Chen Yao sends me in the Minkowski problem, then we have the second derivative bounded. U may not be bounded. So there may be some cancellation between U and the Laplace U. Even H is bounded, no guarantee U is bounded. So now recall that this equation also similar. Sigma k is diverging free, therefore you are free to move U at U by any and coordinate functions. Therefore, we can also assume U satisfy of k, I don't want to use k anymore, but U zero for all alpha in plus one. That's the retraction we want to make. Then claim. So that's equation two. Suppose U satisfy equation one and two, then U is bounded. C only depends on of phi of C2 law, and of course depends on n. That's it. We do need to do, and that's just companion's argument. Suppose that's not true. What do you mean not true? The counter statement. Not true, then you see that originally we have this sigma k of w equal to of phi. Suppose that's not true, then you have a sequence solutions of, and then u is unbounded. And such that this is under control. Phi l c2 is under control. And UL of infinity is going to infinity of S2, Sn. That mean U doesn't have C0. And UL of course satisfies such equation 1 and 2. Okay? That's the solution. Now you do risk here, U delta of L equal to UL over modulo of UL of L infinity. Then apply the estimate we did before. So now using, just erase estimate, right? Recall the estimate, oh yeah, still here. Then you look at, instead of look U delta, look H delta. Therefore, you replace H by, replace U by U delta. Go back to the equation by risk here. You see that? Okay, so now let's write down here. So U L delta I j plus U L delta delta of I j of sigma k, that equal to, because you divide by this, equal to phi over of U of L of L infinity, right? Because homogeneity degree 1. So that's, let's call phi delta of L. Because this is going to infinity, we assume then this is going to infinity, therefore this is going to zero. C2 norms is going to zero, therefore phi delta of L is going to go zero, C2. Just multiply some small or big constant, depends on you put upstairs or downstairs. Now take a limit because of this estimate. Well, because you see that, because you theta L of L0, L infinity, that's equal to 1. Because by this risk here. Therefore, this estimate then, UL theta of C2 is bound from some constant of C. Because of this estimate again, using of this estimate, because this become theta, become of theta. So this is bounded by C, then take a limit. Therefore, then by limit of this estimate here, passing to subsequence, you have a convergence of a U of star the plus plus nu of star that is equal to zero. And u star belong to C1 of alpha, because you, here you only have C1 estimate. Therefore, you pass the limit, you get of C1 alpha. But because now you see that this equation is in standard, that's smooth, because this is C1 alpha, then you lift up, so that's a change. That is what it implies, that because first of all, we know passing limit, that's C1 alpha, but it also satisfies this equation, that implies this, you start from C infinity. And that satisfies this equation. This equation are the first harmonics. And therefore, that means you start belong to the span of S1 to Sn plus 1. And now we assume then all UG are satisfied equation 2. Therefore, U star satisfies 2, that implies since U star satisfies 2, that implies U star must be identical to 0. Because it is in span here, but it's also orthogonal to these functions. So it must be 0. But of course, U star norm of infinity is equal to 1, because that is strong convergence from there. So that's contradiction. Therefore, that cannot be go to infinity. You have this bound. From there, you can use degree theory to prove that you do have an admissible solution. So that answers the first question, Q1. So for any function of that, you can solve it. So now let's get to the second problem. So when a solution, an admissible solution, is geometric. Well, in general, an admissible solution may not be geometric. Let's look at a general example. Let's say xn plus 1, that is the n plus 1's coordinate. Let's call this function of equal to v of 2. Then this function, that u equal to 1 minus of xn plus 1 square of 2, which you can see that, let's set up this one, then u of j plus u delta j is non-negative definite. But this matrix has, but on the grid circle, this matrix of W is of rank of n minus 1. So not full rank. Away from the grid circle, then it is a full rank. Therefore, sigma k, this is a negative function, no problem. So sigma k of u ij plus u delta ij equal to some phi, which is strict positive when k is strictly than n, larger than equal to 1. Okay, because you have a rank of n plus 1, then of course sigma k is always positive, as long as k is less than n. If k equal to n, you take a product with 0. So therefore, now what you do then, of course, this is positive, you can still think about it, then u minus epsilon. For epsilon small enough, also satisfy certain equation. Therefore, that is not geometric. This sigma k of ij plus u minus epsilon delta ij, that's equal to some phi of epsilon still positive. For epsilon small enough. And it is u minus epsilon is not, so this ij plus u delta ij, and that's equal to, has a negative eigenvalue. On the grid circle. So, we would have, what the example tell you then, even you have right-hand side, which is positive and negative, you can find a solution which is not geometric. So So there must be some condition you need to impose in order to get a geometric solution. So the rest, should I finish?
3:45.
I cannot be that 3:45. I start at 1:45.
3:50.
Okay, so that's the main thing we want to discuss today. That's so-called the issue of converting. So this go back to Tabarelli, Friedman, and Yao. This in 1980s, very nice idea. So what, of course, to prove then a matrix is positive, definite, then more or less you want to prove that to estimate the eigenvalue from below. Well, you can do that, put it in those condition will be very, very short, not realistic. So what's the idea is then, assume, suppose eigenvalue certain time touches zero. I didn't want to rule out this case and the condition. So idea is the following here. Create a strong maximum principle. Okay, now let me explain a little bit. So what do we assume then? So again, we are using method of continuity. When you start, of course, you start something very nice. Then when t goes, then you want to prove then around that deformation path, the convergence will be preserved. Suppose convergence failed to preserve, what happened? Then you're coming from convex, also, we have all kind of estimates that mean the solution will be continuous in C2 norm or C3 norm, whatever you like. Therefore, convergent fields then at least at a certain point T, there is a point in SN such that the matrix is still somewhat positive definite, but there is certain way there is zero eigenvalue. So now assume that W is no negative definite, and then suppose this point, and then the rank of W, the maximum rank of W, the minimum rank of W of X, and then the minimum of this, and X derivative of Sn. Suppose this rank is not full rank, equal to L, which is less than of n. Then we want to impose certain condition to prove that this cannot be true. Okay. So now, because rank is an integer number, therefore must be attained. Okay. Therefore, there is an x zero such that the rank of w x zero is equal to the minimum rank of W. Okay. And let's call this rank equal to L. Then because we see that, let's recall the equation of 1, sigma k of W equal to of phi, which is positive. Therefore, L must be larger than to k. Because k is positive, the rank at least of k. Okay, so we have a semi-definite and a positive definite matrix, and the rank is of L, and L is strictly less than n. Okay. So L is strictly less than n. So now we want to define this function, the equal to of the L plus 1 of W. This function, of course, is a smooth function. Then we want to prove then the following here. at any amplifier, maybe near. Well, once you can prove them, this, then you are done. So maximum point will tell you then phi will be identical to zero. Because phi at zero is zero. Because this rank is L. Now you put L plus one. Okay, so that's zero. Then this must be identical to zero. Near of a zero. And then this is also, from here, it is also open. Therefore, phi near a zero, that implies phi will be identical to zero on the whole SA. And this cannot be true. There is a Minkowski identity can prove that this cannot be true. The identity tells you then sigma L plus 1 of W equal to some Cn dependent L U of sigma L of W. And sigma L W is positive everywhere. U is no negative. And then cannot be identical to zero. Okay? So that. Alright, so the question when this should be true, I call star. So we want to prove star. Well, star in general cannot be true, as example, for example, tell you. So we need a condition. So now we want to state the following. So this case, you see that when we do C2 estimate, we explore so-called certain concavity properties of sigma k. But this time, you want to prove you want to estimate the smallest eigenvalue in some sense. Then you want to explore certain convexity instead of concavity. So that is very important. So now I want to state the lemma. So now let's recall here, the equation is sigma k of W equal to 5. Then suppose phi maximum over k of delta ij plus phi maximum over k is larger than equal to zero. On Sn, then start equal. So this gives you the sufficient condition. Well, maybe I want to explain a little bit of this one here. So this is a function we want to prescribe originally. And then what you do then, you extend this function, phi maximum of k, extend of this function, 2 of rn plus 1 by homogeneous degree 1. That's equivalent to this function is convex in rn, standard and the sense, rn sense. That means a spherical case. Delta ij. Okay, so that is the Jovan meaning of this. Okay, so now the rest of this lecture, we devote the proof of this lemma. Okay, so if this condition holds, then we have all that inequality. So now let's, before I do that, I'm going to write down inequality again. So sigma k of ij of phi of ij is less than equal to c1 and phi plus of c2 reading of phi. Okay, we want to prove this. All right, so now the rest probably computation is a little messy, but I want to outline the main idea. Okay, so now pick S point in Sn that is equal to W at zero, the rank is equal to the minimal rank of W, and that's equal to of L. So now we have a point here, then let's take a small neighborhood of that point at zero. because now W is continuous and smooth enough. And now you have this rank. So at S0 you have, and suppose you have, so you have of N minus L of eigenvalues, which is 0, because rank is L. Then you have L eigenvalue is positive. So nearby that point, you still have L is, so near that point at 0, then let's call W1 of W of L, that is large one, so. And then WL minus 1 of W of L near the point X. So if X near that, then you have this will be larger than equal to some delta 0, larger than 0, because at S0 is not 0. Near X0, of course, is still larger than some positive constant. And this will be very small, because at S0 is 0, and eigenvalue is a continuous function of the matrix. Therefore, this will be very small. So now you can separate eigenvalues, which is always larger than certain and the positive constant, other is very, very small. So we are working in this very small neighborhood of zero. Okay, so this is very small. So now let's call this GR, so this eigenvalue of lambda J is larger than delta zero. And all those indices appear, lambda G is less than it. So you have bad indices, and you have good indices. So now you can see from here, because you see phi itself is equal to sigma L plus 1 of W. Now you write down that's equivalent to C, that's equal to of sigma L of G, then sigma 1 of B. Otherwise, so eigenvalue of the sigma K, sigma L plus 1 are the product of different, and L plus 1 different eigenvalues. Then the dominant one is this one. The rest will be high order. Therefore, the sigma 1 of B is summation of the bad eigenvalues. Therefore, this also, and so therefore, that means then lambda G is also and the equivalent is dominated by sigma 1 over B if G is bound to B, because summation of that. So this we use quite often. Now let's look what is the gradient of phi. So gradient of phi, the point that's equal to, well, you write on that, that's by definition, the suppose of I that is equal to sigma L plus 1 of IJ of W of IJ, alpha beta of I. But if we assume at the point, then W is diagonal, you can always rotate such diagonal. At each point of X, you compute, not just X0. At each point you compute, you can always as diagonal, then eigenvalues, you have separate eigenvalues, so this one here. Once anything here, this will be equal to sigma L and omega, taking the alpha's eigenvalue away, and then you let W alpha of I, because it's diagonal. Okay? You differentiate of sigma L plus 1 with respect to W alpha beta, and then alpha not equal to beta 0, alpha equal to beta, you get this. Take it in a value away. So now you can look here to see what's happened here. So this will be equal to, so that is of I. This, then you look here, when you have L, if alpha belong to G, there are L numbers in G. You take one away, at the most L minus one number. Then take of sigma L plus 1, you can have at least something coming from B there. So then this will be equivalent to of this one. Therefore, that's it's kind of equivalent. Just you don't take G instead of sigma L, then summation W of alpha of I, alpha belong to B. You take it, take anything from G that's equivalent to zero. Because you only have L good eigenvalues, so take one away, at most L minus one eigenvalues, take it, and symmetric function of L, then you have at least involve something from B. Okay? So that is, so those are two equivalent we have. So to write down of this estimate, eventually, so more or less I'm going to throw away all those equivalent. So in quadrimean equivalent, you module of these kind of things. So now we compute. Take alpha of beta, differentiate in alpha in beta, that's equal to, well, because we will contract with, so we will contract sigma t of alpha beta, we want to do this. That's the origin we want. Because we assume W is diagonal, therefore alpha has to be equal to beta, otherwise equal to zero. So this sigma L plus 1, so sigma k of alpha alpha. Then a lot of things happen here, so that will be sigma L plus 1 and of beta, then W beta, beta of alpha alpha. Then you also have and take sigma L plus 1. I don't want to use alpha because I j L of L. Then W of IJ of alpha, WLM of alpha, just general. Okay, this we get, because we assume diagonal, therefore that's equal to sigma K of alpha alpha, and that's still keep. And that we commute W alpha alpha beta beta minus and okay, so alpha beta, sigma of alpha, L, W of alpha alpha plus U of beta beta. Alpha. Then, so that's taking about this one. Then now taking about that one. So this one, if W is diagonal, then there are only two cases. Things not equal to zero. So the first is sigma of I, j and j, l plus one. Then w of I of alpha, w, j, j of alpha. That's I not equal to j. Then you have the negative term. I not equal to j, sigma l plus one of I, j and j. Then of WIG of alpha square. And then you put all things together. Now, you put this, of course, put down sigma K of alpha alpha, then let's take care of this first. So let's take care of that one. That will be equal to, that is K, a homogeneous degree of K, so that will be minus of k sigma k. And then you take this will be homogeneous degree of L plus 1, you get back to sigma L plus 1. Sigma L plus 1 is almost equivalent to 0. We can ignore that. So this goes away. So this one goes away. Equivalent. And this have to be a little careful, then we put things back. So then this will be do the very similar we did before. Then you differential equation of this one here, so it becomes sigma k of beta beta. But differential sigma k beta beta first term coming of this one, then there's another term minus sigma L plus 1 beta beta, and then sigma k of IG and LM. And WIJ of beta and WLM of beta. So then just taking care of that one. So this will taken care. And then let's copy of everything here. Well, I want to simplify things a little bit. I want to state a very simple but very useful lemma of checkers lemma. If f is larger than equal to 0 down to C2, then the gradient of f at any point can be controlled by and some constant of f of half. That's in general not true if you drop this assumption, even C2. If x equal to x, gradient equal to 1, and then of course this is half of x, cannot be true. Okay, so then we need this assumption. So that's little lemma, calculating lemma. Well, so that's the lemma we use this lemma. We see, so that is the lemma we will use. So now let's see some of the things here. So this part, then, so all those things eventually will be summation together. So let's look what's happened to here. This also can be changed. This can be write down, this just leave this here. And this one sigma l plus 1 of beta beta. This again use the original thing here, sigma k of I j j I not equal to j, then w of I of beta w j j of beta minus sigma k, maybe I put together sigma k w I j beta of square. So that's taking care of this one. And this copy together. So this copy together, don't touch it. So now let's examine some of the things, simplify a little bit. So in all those submissions, let's see what's happened here. Suppose now of all I and j belong to B, if all I and j belong to B, then the gradient of W of I gradient W j j will be less than or equal to, because this one is less than or equal to half of W of, which is put F equal to W I. W I is and no negative definite. So that's the half of W I, the half of W j j. So that's come C of W of I of half, W J J of half. And then Ko Schwarz tell you that this is less than equal to phi, some C. I J belong to all this. So that is, so therefore you can assume then cannot then mean I J, at least one of them it is and in of G. On the other hand, suppose now, let's look on here. So suppose now, W, so we are dealing with here. So say usually sigma and any sigma n of I and j, that's equal to, and sigma n minus 2 taking of lambda, taking of I away, taking j away. Just very easy to compute. Suppose now one of these is in G, other in B. So I in B, so this is taking care of all those IJ in B. So now we're dealing with one I in B, J in G. So that's taking care of the I in B, J in G. So therefore, then With I, you are free to take away because it's zero. So therefore, that equal to sigma n minus 2 of lambda of g equivalent. Everything but n value you are free to take or free to add. Okay. So use of this factor here, then you can see then sigma k, sigma m, and of I, g of g, I not equal to j, w of I of any differentiation w j j of alpha, that's equivalent to zero, equivalent to of gradient of phi. You can prove that because you take the wing of here, then because then this will be have j, and it's independent I. You sum I, then you get out this thing. So this also taking care about all those terms here, and so, and you also have here, those terms are all taken away as long as one is belong to G. So therefore both have to belong to G, B, both have to belong to G, okay? So that's taken care of. So now, okay. With this, keep this in mind. Now, maybe I just keep this in mind, so this is going away. And also, look here, this has to be here, alpha beta L, therefore this, you cannot have anything of I here. So this also, you have to take I. So sigma L cos 1 beta beta, that is equal to sigma L of lambda taking beta away. Then, and this equivalent to 0, your beta belongs to G. Because you only have L, no 0 eigenvalues, or eigenvalues born from below, or other small. If you take a bigger one of the bigger away, then one of other small must be involved. Therefore, that is 0. Therefore, this means then sigma L beta beta on here, beta have to be in B, cannot be in G. Okay? So this also taking care. So that means this have to be beta have to be in G, but be in B. And this is also and give us problem, but this also eventually will be okay. So that's in B. Then this can be at least if the one of that in B also in okay. Therefore both must be in G. So put all this together, I'm not going to do the detail, then I'm going to write down what the computation looks like. So now doing all those kind of things, then we have phi of alpha beta, sigma k of alpha of beta, that's equal to equivalent. Phi belong to B, phi of L of G, phi of II minus K of phi. Minus sigma L of G, alpha must equal to beta, sigma K minus 2 of G of alpha beta, W alpha alpha, W of beta of I, minus 2, sigma K plus minus 1, G of alpha, sigma L minus 1, G of alpha, W of alpha alpha of I squared. And again, here alpha has to be. Okay, now let's examine of this phi I of I. So now Now, manually I put something here, so minus, so this, I put an edit here, minus phi of I square, 1 plus 1 over 2, and then you have add about phi of I square, minus phi. So I put something here, then add of this, and then I put this double copy, this 1, and then leave of this, so this, maybe I put here. G of alpha, then I take this away, so let's put this together, then minus G of A over G, and I belong to B, I copy this back, right, this should be plus, so then you have of this here, so then minus sign, yeah, let's see my trick, G of alpha, so that this one of k is still not complete yet. So I put this plus 5 of I square inside here. Then I put 1 over k, 5 of I square of 5, 5 here. Okay, so I just fold something here. And then, of course, you have to check. Subtract one from this term and subtract this one from term. And the game here, then we will prove that this one is no positive, this one is no positive. And then you can see from here, this one is then equal to the differentiation of the term original condition we have. Okay, so let's do the first easy case first. So let's look at this one here. So we already compute then phi of I. That's equivalent to of sigma k and minus 1 of g of alpha, alpha belongs to g, and the w of alpha of I, and then you take square, and then that will be equal to square of that, that's equal to sigma k minus 1 g of alpha of square, w of alpha I square, then plus of sigma k minus 1 g of alpha and sigma k minus 1 g of beta, then w alpha of I, w beta of I not beta not equal to alpha, and all belong to g. So that's equal to this one here. So now, so that is this one here. So now, then you put a look on this one, compare with this one, and then use Cauchy-Weiss. And the property of this sigma k of g of alpha and the W of alpha equal to and K minus 1 sigma K of G, use this identity and this will be no negative. Let me just compute manually. You will see why this is no negative. Okay, so we have of this, and no positive. We have also that, but this one, you want to, let's look here, so you take of square, you have this term here, then you multiply of sigma of k on both sides, so that's equivalent to say then, something, no, it's not GL, sorry, there's no GL here, the GL is opposite, so OGL. So now then you take out this square something, not real. This GL here. So now use of that, let me see, something right. So this GL, that this one was our GL, so it's a blanket of the little blanket here. Okay, this one, not no blanket here, so that is, what's that one? that's it, already homogeneity and the right. So that's maybe homogeneity and right. So with all this one here, then you squish once, you take a look on this one, divide by this here, you multiply this part here, that becomes much here, and then this and then easy computation tells you then you squish once, and then take care about that. Squish once, use of this. What you do then, you multiply AO there, and then put AO of down here. So what do you do? Maybe I do this one here. So sigma T of I, the square, that's equal to of sigma of AO, that's equal to sigma AO of half of G. So G put inside there, then you have of this. Maximum G of alpha, W of alpha, alpha I, and square. Now, this one, let me see. So of I square. Of square. I want what I want. I want you to cancel with this one. I want to cancel with that one. So that's the k minus 1 of alpha. K minus 1 of alpha. W of I. Okay. So this one I put down there. So will be of sigma, notice then sigma L that is equal to sigma L minus 1 of G of alpha and the lambda W lambda of alpha, because G is a full rank. Using this factor here. So therefore, what I do is then, let me see, sigma L, I want to make sigma L there, sigma L minus 1 of G of alpha of half, a number of alpha of half. So now this half put in here, alpha of half, and this put half here, and sigma k of minus 1 of half, another half here. Okay, so this one combines that, and this one combined with this. Okay, maybe I will write that in a more careful way. So sigma k of sigma L minus 1 G of alpha of half, and sigma k minus 1 G of alpha is W of alpha alpha of I, then sigma of half, sigma k minus 1 of half G of alpha, and lambda of alpha of half, or square. Okay, now almost there. So now you could use this and that. So that will be, take a square of that, as you could do, of sigma L, G of minus 1, G of alpha, sigma K minus 1 of G of alpha, W of alpha, alpha I of square, and then you take a product of sigma K minus 1 of half of alpha, alpha, G of alpha, lambda of alpha. Okay, so this is a clever way to rearrange that. And this is that what you have here. Okay, what's this? Because by K homogeneity, that's equal to K of G of sigma K of G. Then you divide by K, exactly the same. So this also is given 5 here. So that's taking care about that. So this one takes care. So I don't have time. I'll claim this is also non-native. This non-native is much more difficult here. So I leave. How much time I have? I still have 5 minutes. Okay. If you still have energy to continue, then we continue. Otherwise, you want to take a break. Then we come back tomorrow, probably for next lecture. But maybe better leave next lecture because things are getting a little messy. And let's clean up our heads for a while. Then tomorrow we have fresh air to restart things again. Thank you.
All right. Are there any questions?
The crystal problem now, is it completely solved or not?
Crystal problem in theory is completely solved. Because, okay, maybe just see. Crystal problem is then exactly equal to find of nu equal to 5, k equal to 1. And now you see then the solution is binary. So in some sense, it's a complete solution. In other sense, it's no sense. Because then you can find, because it's green function of that. So then you can write down u equal to something green function of x or y, say, of phi of y. And then you want to ask when this solution is complex. Once in some sense, then you can, then what you do then, just look at, check out that you differentiate of this and check what's happened there by this integral condition. So it's not easy at all to verify when this condition is satisfied. The condition is complete pull imposed by integration. So it is complete, necessary, and sufficient, but there's no claim.
Interesting, but I think Pogorelov makes some conditions.
Yes, okay, so that's, yeah, you're right. So Pogorelov, what we have, Pogorelov assume the following, and if I remember correctly, then phi of ii minus phi is less than equal to 0. That's his condition. Then if you look at the condition we had here, then is phi of ii minus phi of I square of 2 and plus minus phi is less than equal to 0. It's a little better than his. And this is in some sense more geometric. You have geometric meaning.
But it's not optimal.
No. It's, so that's coming tomorrow, coming back tomorrow, you see that this condition is not optimal. And it is still far from optimal. And turns out here, this estimate is not yet an effective estimate. That means we cannot get an explicit bound of low, a lower bound of eigenvalue. Turns out then tomorrow we come back, there is in an explicit bound. But that bound is very complicated. So we will discuss this again tomorrow. Tomorrow we come back, we finish the rest of here, then we move to the curvature equation, problem of prescribed curvature measure.
What was the reason?
What is reason?
What was the reason that crystal permitted conjecture? Do you know?
Oh, there are many big mathematicians, big name, Hilbert and Hurwitz and others who stumble on this problem. First of all, this problem is linear. This as probably crystal was conjecture, the problem probably even older than Minkowski's, in a sense. So then the original in convex theory is the principal radius you sum up. That's exactly what you want to find the inverse problem. So that's the inverse problem. That's the original.
Minkowski probably is more natural.
But. Yeah, I agree. Yeah.
Are there some functionals that you can prescribe that, or that you can write down that help you, like the procedure?
About what?
For this prescribing these curvature measures or area measures, are there some functionals that you can use to help you? Like prescribing Gauss curvature on the sphere or something like that?
No. Because when you move from n to k, since because Gauss curvature you can always solve. And once you move n to k, it's a different story.
not much we can do for non-convex case.
No convex, yeah, tomorrow we come back to deal with non-convex case for the curvature equation. But for this equation in general, solution is this admissible, but there is no geometric, then you cannot recover the convex body.
Okay, if there are no more questions, let's thank Pengfei.
I don't know.